Live from Chicago, this is Bruce Dumont with our Beyond the Beltway analysis of national politics, featuring occasional injections of rumor and innuendo, all offered up by our panel of political insiders, pundits, power brokers, public servants, professors, and most importantly, plain-speaking Americans from coast to coast. Tonight, featuring commentary by Democrat Phil Beverly, Republican Marty Garrity, Republican Josh Cantrow, and Democrat Christine Schombacher. Our program tonight coming to you from our own base at the Museum of Broadcast Communications in Chicago, where our toll-free lines are open at 1-800-723-8289. That's 1-800-723-8289. If you'd like to email me a comment, it's beyondthebeltway2019 at Gmail. And, of course, if you want to join us, send me a tweet. It's at Dumo, at D-U-M-O. And, of course, you can join us live on beyondthebeltway.com, not only this week, but past shows can be found there. And, of course, we are live tonight on Facebook, and we are live tonight on YouTube around the country and around the world. Nice to have you with us. We have lots to talk about. Again, we have been talking about the possibility of an impeachment inquiry into the President of the United States for several months on this program. It happened last week, as you all know. So we'll be talking about that and the possibility of further impeachment discussions as the program unfolds, and really as the program unfolds for the next several weeks or several months, likely in this country. And I just want to make a pledge, and I hope I can live up to this pledge. And that is, and this was the same pledge that we made during the Clinton impeachment, which is not, we're not there yet, but obviously it started with an inquiry as well. I want to pledge to you that each and every Sunday night we're going to have four people. Two are going to be in favor of an impeachment inquiry or impeachment, and two that are going to be vehemently opposed to it. We did the same thing for Bill Clinton. We're going to have spirited discussions. Hopefully they're going to be based in some fact in addition to erudite opinion. But that's what we're going to try to do on this program. And again, if you're looking to try to get just one side of the discussion and the debate on this program, at least for the next several months, you probably aren't going to find it all here, because we want, I do believe that what the Founding Fathers had in mind, and I didn't know any of them personally, but I think what they really had in mind is that the public, the electorate, would be informed. And again, thinking, when you think back to the Founding Fathers, you don't quite figure out how they were going to be informed, because there weren't many newspapers and radio and TV was not around. But they expected an intelligent electorate to make decisions on the future of the country. We are there right now. We have a country that is divided, at least according to statistically, and we'll discuss it tonight as well as many months and hopefully years to come on Beyond the Beltway. We're going to begin. Christine Schombacher joins us. Christine, nice to have you with us. A maiden voyage. You are an attorney. You're a liberal. You're running for Congress. You're running to retire Danny Davis, the longtime representative of this district where this program comes from, the 7th Congressional District of Illinois. So I'm going to begin with a question to you. I know that you favor the impeachment inquiry. Of all the things you know about Donald Trump or have read about Donald Trump, which is the thing that is most egregious to you and you're most upset about?
It is the Ukraine call. It is a clear line. Even Democrats who won in deeply red zones and are more moderate, so I'm talking about what they call themselves, the badasses, so Alyssa Slotkin, Chrissy Houlihan, it was a bright line rule for them, or that he crossed a bright line, because he is asking another government to come and again interfere with our elections and to, you know, take a swipe at his political opponent.
So you're a newcomer to the inquiry. In other words, if we would have had you on a month ago, would you still have been for an impeachment inquiry?
Oh, absolutely. The 10 counts of obstruction of justice that should have been acted on. There should have been an impeachment inquiry.
So you go back to the Mueller report.
Absolutely.
Josh Cantrow, you're one of our card-carrying Republicans tonight. Your reaction to the decision by the House Democrats to move forward with an inquiry?
Look, this House has wanted, the Democrats have wanted to impeach this president since the day he was elected, before he was even inaugurated, and they have stated so. So it didn't surprise me. At some point, they were going to move on impeachment. Their progressive base was demanding it, and you know, he handed them a little bit of opportunity here, although I certainly don't think he should be impeached over this.
Okay. Phil Beverly joins us. Phil, nice to have you with us. My recollection is that the last time on this program, you were not quite ready to get behind an impeachment inquiry. You were sort of on the side of the speaker. Is that a fair assessment of what your opinion was, and how has it changed?
The phone call and the use of code word classified servers is really problematic for me. The line between protecting the country and our national security and whatever your political aspirations and behavior is, those have to remain separate and inviolate, and that to me has been violated. He's already attacked the intelligence community unjustifiably. He's already attacked the law enforcement community unjustifiably. Enough. Stop with the cover-up. Stop dragging people into this nonsense. The thing that just tells me how much of an amateur Donald Trump is that he's got incumbency advantage already. What's he doing this amateur hour stuff for?
Marty Garrity also joins us. Marty, you are a card-carrying Republican, but again, for longtime viewers of this program, because you've been a guest many, many times for many, many years, you were not a big Donald Trump fan during the primary.
There were 17 Republicans at the time, and he was my 17th choice. And when one dropped out, he became my 16th choice. And until he became the only choice, he was.
So where do you stand now? Because some of the reservations that you had then, when you had 16 choices ahead of him, I would assume that some of those reasons are still alive and fresh today.
Well, he's a little bit coarser than I would choose to have my president be, but I got to tell you, compared to anybody that he has either run against or is likely to be running against, he is far and away better for me than those people. So, you know, I'm a gung-ho Trump supporter now in terms of when he's running against any of the, whether it's Elizabeth Warren or Joe Biden or Pete. Actually, I kind of like Pete Buttigieg because he just seems like a fellow that you could sit down and talk with. But I don't like any of these candidates for their political points of view.
How about Mark Sanford?
I'm sorry?
How about Mark Sanford?
No.
So you don't like Republicans either?
Well, I don't like...
With questionable backgrounds.
Yeah, I mean, Mark Sanford...
Not that the president does.
If we knew he was going to stay in the U.S. and not go to Argentina, I might be okay. But.
Christine, do you believe, as some media people have suggested, that the speaker got rolled, she got pressured? This is not something she really wants to do, but she looked up, put her finger in the air, and realized that the leftward movers and shakers in the House convinced some of the more moderates that you referenced in your opening commentary. There was no other decision she could have made this past week.
I think Speaker Pelosi is brilliant, and no one can roll her. She makes her own decisions, and I think this was a very well-thought-out analytical decision that came from her and understanding that a bright line was crossed.
Okay. 1-800-723-8029 from coast to coast and border to border. I'd like to find out from the people out there beyond the Beltway, how do you feel about the impeachment inquiry? Do you support it? Are you against it? If you want to tell us whether you're a Republican or Democrat, you can do that. You don't have to. But we'd like to hear from you. Are you cheering the decisions of the Democrats last week, or are you holding them, at least personally, in contempt of your personal political opinions? Back shortly.
A line is a powerful thing. It connects the global economy to your living room. Cleaner air to stronger markets. Factory floors to less crowded roads. Today's progress to tomorrow's promise. Norfolk Southern. One line, infinite possibilities.
Oh, hello. You know, these days, I'm often quoted as saying, you can't believe everything you read on the internet. People forget that I was the first technology president using the telegraph, T-mails as I like to call them, to communicate with my generals. Well, today, we are fighting a cybersecurity war, And our best defense is for folks to follow some of these tips when they're online. If it seems too good to be true, it probably is. Hover your cursor over links to determine the true web address. Look for misspellings and poor grammar, which are warning signs of fraud. Be suspicious of emails requesting urgent action, and never give away sensitive personal information. With malware for none, with cyber protection for all, this is your humble servant, Abraham Lincoln.
Big three out there. Bruce DuMont back in Chicago. We continue with our broadcast, and I want to go back to a key part of this conversation. We talked about the call. The Democrats were offended by the call. Were the Republicans offended by the call? Were you offended, Josh?
I was not offended by the call. I thought that the mention toward the end of the call, the one mention of Biden, which was toward the end of this 45-minute yes. call, was inappropriate, but I was not offended by it. What I am offended by is the way the media and the Democrats are spinning this. This call was about getting foreign countries to invest more in Ukraine. The U.S. is shouldering a disproportionate burden in that regard. And at the end of the call, there's this discussion about Biden.
But he didn't really say that. In the call, he didn't say that. He did not make any reference in that call, the one that we're aware of. He did not make any reference to the fact that that things were being held up, that he wanted the other European nations to assist and give more money. He didn't bring that up. That might have come up in some other conversation, but not in the call.
Well, I think he talked about Merkel and Macron.
He did.
Not giving enough. Actually,
So you think he made his case?
Oh, I think
in the call.
Bruce, can I quote from the call?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Is this, you don't have
is this from the call, or is this from the 10 people who listened to it and made notes about it?
You can't. That's a summary.
That's a summary.
Okay.
So let's not say the call, because we don't know what was in the call.
Fair enough.
Okay.
My friend Phil, fair enough.
Good.
This is a summary of the call. Zelensky responds, quote, "You are absolutely right, not only 100%, but actually 1,000%. He tells Trump that German Chancellor Angela Merkel and the French president, quote, are not working as much as they should work for Ukraine. And he says that, quote, the European Union should be our biggest partner, but technically the United States is a much bigger partner than the European Union. End of quote.
That Which is all what he's using so that he can say, do what I asked. Like, I'm a big helper for you. No one else is helping you like I am, so you have to now help me.
No, that's what Zelensky said. Zelensky said, you're right that these other countries aren't doing enough to help. And that was the thrust of the
call. That's helping our argument, though, that he recognizes that the United States is a huge help, which, by the way, Trump had withheld $400 million worth of aid prior to this.
But it seems like he didn't know that Trump had done that, but that's...
Well,
I don't
somebody
think there's any
did.
Evidence that...
Somebody did, because there were diplomatic personnel that were calling back to the States wondering, where's the aid that's supposed to be coming here?
Well, Zelensky apparently did not know about that. That is what's been said and really not gainsaid since this started. This
is a classic shakedown language, though. We've been so good to you. This is what I need. Here's direct contacts in the U.S. government that I want you to work with.
And so let's exonerate him then.
There has been a lot said that there is no direct quid pro quo.
Correct.
Who agrees with that?
I agree. There's nothing on that call about quid pro quo.
We don't know that because we haven't heard
Here's my
call
question.
In its entirety.
When conversations like this, not this one because we don't have the exact words, when conversations like this have happened in the past, first of all, do you all agree that there have been conversations like this in the past between the leader of the free world, whoever that might be, and a foreign leader at some point? Does everyone agree that these conversations happen?
Sure. This is
routine. Do you ever think that they are, is there frequently a quid pro quo involved in those conversations, even though it may not be stated?
Are you asking if there's conversations where you put the president puts their personal interests above the
national interest?
I don't think that that's happened.
But that's not what happened here either.
That is what happened here.
That is not.
He's having a foreign government go after.
As soon as you introduce Joe Biden into it, that's what happens.
Yes. So, no, I don't think. I think this is a whole new era that Trump has brought us into, a whole new chaotic, undemocratic, violating our laws, and no other president has ever done this.
So that's all great opinion, but let's get back to the facts. Why didn't Trump bring up other Democratic candidates? Why did he bring up Joe Biden? Because there's an ongoing investigation into Joe Biden and his son Hunter's activities in Ukraine.
By whom?
And he is asking that there is a DOJ investigation. The Ukrainians are investigating that.
I thought DOJ said that they weren't commenting on whether there was an investigation or not. Is this breaking news?
No, this is absolutely not breaking news. One of the things that the Inspector General and whoever, John Dunham is looking into is what were the origins and Ukraine's role in this whole Russia collusion deal?
Well, John Dunham, who's the U.S. Attorney in Connecticut, he is the one that's preparing a report now which looks into the very origins of the fusion GPS and all aspects of people who think that our Justice Department and our FBI were somehow involved in leaking information and perpetuating information out to get candidate Donald Trump.
Right.
He's investigating that now.
And Ukraine is part of that.
Well, it obviously is based on these conversations. So I'm saying is that, but to involve him now, I think is maybe the cart before the horse. The point is, there was an investigation going on to Hunter Biden, and the Biden administration wanted it stopped. Allegedly, other nations in the world wanted it stopped. They didn't like that investigator, and they used their influence, I believe, to try to get that investigator fired, and he was fired.
But was he fired because he was corrupt?
But Bruce, no, Joe Biden never raised his hand and said, you know what? I shouldn't be involved in this because my son Hunter, who is really never succeeded at anything in his life and has had drug problems and other things and has no expertise in natural gas at all, is sitting on the board and making $50,000 a month.
This is all a distraction from what President Trump did.
No, but let's put it in context, okay? Is this a distraction from the facts that we're discussing this evening? Potentially. But if you're going to have an investigation and you're a lawyer, if you begin to unravel the thread, you don't quite know where it's going to end up. And in this particular case, Josh is right. There's no evidence that Joe Biden at that point was doing anything more than maybe trying to help his son. And was it appropriate, let me ask our Democrats, was it appropriate for the son of the Vice President of the United States to sit on this firm, which is being investigated by Ukrainian judicial authorities? Was it proper for him to do that when Joe Biden had the responsibility of negotiating and dealing with the United States' relationship with Ukraine? Does that stink to either of our Democrats? Yes or no?
Biden and Hunter have not violated any U.S. laws. And if we want to talk about...
I'm not talking about
Ivanka Trump and what she's doing in China and those 13 trademark deals that she just got. Does that also... Well,
no, that's what is them. But what I would say is, yes, that's a little suspect. But for the Democrats to somehow acknowledge or not say, wait, that looks stinky to me. I mean, come on, that was stinky. It looks stinky. And if there's more that's going on between Biden in his official capacity and going to China with his son on Air Force Two and discussing matters with the China, which we don't know much about at the moment, that stinks too.
And Bruce, this is not something that is a right-wing talking point and that we're making up out of thin air.
I don't think so.
There is a political story, which I would encourage all your viewers to Google. July 1, left of center Politico, which talks about all the money various Biden family members have made throughout his career as a politician. So I don't want to just pick on Hunter. There are other Biden family members, including his brother, that have made money inappropriately off Biden's political connections. And then you have the New Yorker running a story the very next month
Okay.
5,000-word essay detailing all the things wrong with Hunter and Biden's relationship.
Okay, let's go to Christine.
Okay, again, one, if we're going to go down this road, we absolutely need to start looking at Trump and his children and how they've been profiting
haven't
overseas.
Haven't we done that?
No.
And then two, if you actually believe that there's some sort of impropriety there, which I do not agree with you, if you do believe that, then the proper channel for the President of the United States is to go to the Department of Justice, not to solicit a foreign country to start interfering with our elections. This, what you're all talking about, is a distraction from
that's
the real
not what
issue
he did.
That he asked a foreign government to get involved in United States affairs. He crossed a clear, bright line.
Marty, did he?
He didn't cross a clear, bright line. He said, there's a favor I'd like to ask you. And he didn't say, I want you to invent things about Joe Biden. He said, just look into this issue for me, because if indeed, I mean, either Biden was involved in something or he wasn't. I mean, I think we can all agree on that. If you think he wasn't involved in something, then the investigation would prove that, and that's all that Trump was asking.
The investigator, the original investigator, the guy that was dumped,
right.
He said on NBC with Richard Engel the other evening, he said that during his tenure of looking into this matter, there was nothing that Joe Biden or Biden Jr., as he referred to him, had done. They had not violated any Ukrainian law. He made the point, Ukrainian law. So according to Ukrainian law, the Bidens did nothing wrong based on the prosecutor who was fired.
The crooked prosecutor.
No, the other prosecutor.
So
the crooked one hasn't commented.
But we haven't looked at it in terms of U.S. law. What I'd like to know, I'd like the Republicans to go on the offensive and get all the phone conversations between Joe Biden and the Ukrainians. I'd like to see all the text messages and conversations and emails between Joe and Hunter Biden at this time. Okay, it's time for
that'll
the Republicans
come during the general election.
Yeah, well, so, it's time to go.
While we're hunting for phone calls,
but I want to disabuse us of the notion that that Trump did anything wrong here. Trump, the favor he asked for had to do with CrowdStrike and Ukraine's involvement in the whole Russian investigation.
Explain CrowdStrike when we come back for those that are not familiar with it.
Say something.
And you're going to say that as well. But first of all, we're going to pause. All of our stations are going to go their merry way. They're going to sell some stuff, and then we'll be back in 3 minutes.
Flintstones, meet the Flintstones. They're the modern Stone family. From the town of Bethlehem, meet George Jetson.
With instant acceleration, electric cars are more fun to drive and more affordable than ever. Electric cars are here. Plug in to the present.
Dallas, St. Louis, Nashville, Tuscaloosa. All major cities to feel the destruction caused by a direct hit from a tornado. Is Chicago next? It's not a question of if, but when, and the clock is ticking. Learn what to do now at ready.illinois.gov to become tornado ready.
Chicago, thanks very much for joining us. And now is the time that we ask each of our guests to introduce themselves. And we begin tonight with a newcomer. She is Christine Schonbacher.
Hello, Christine. I am an attorney, and I'm the Democratic candidate for Illinois 7th Congressional District.
And why do you want to run for Congress?
I want to run for Congress because we're leading the world in prison population, mass shootings, and guns per capita. And decades ago, we did lead in education and infrastructure. We're not doing that anymore, but we can. And I'm an attorney with significant human rights victories, and I want to take those victories from the courthouse into the halls of Congress and move us forward so that we're leading in universal health care, quality of life, human rights, infrastructure, education, green energy.
Now, you mentioned that America has one of the largest prison populations. The 7th Congressional District of Illinois, where you are running, has the largest ex-offender community in the United States. The person that you want to get rid of is Danny Davis, who has been a leader in making life easier for those who have been incarcerated. So how do you address that portion of your alleged constituency or potential constituency, trying to get rid of someone who at least for that constituency has done some, at least attempts to do some good things?
Yeah, Danny Davis has been a great representative. Danny Davis has been a great congressman, and he is a civil rights leader. But in the last few years, he's not coming out and showing up like he needs to. He's not representing the district with the adequacy and energy that it needs. His voting record is almost triple, absence is almost triple that of average. He's not coming out into events like our mayor's historical inauguration. He was not in attendance. And when things are happening, like the government kidnapped 3 children at O'Hare and tried to use the children as pawns to deport their parents, he was silent about that. And the silence is deafening. And this seat, it's 89% blue, or approximately.
Right.
It should be a sledgehammer of a seat. It should be a pain point in this administration, and it's not. And we need a new troop on the ground, because we have issues. The GOP is absolutely coming for Roe. What's happening at our borders is a human rights crisis. And we need to end the failed war on drugs.
Okay, thank you for your introduction. With my questions followed up, Josh Cantrow, are you announcing for anything tonight?
I am not announcing for anything, because I don't think there is any positions that I could win as a Republican and living in the city of Chicago.
Okay.
But I'm a Republican and pro-Israel activist and a cybersecurity attorney, what I do for during the
Philip
day.
Philip Beverly joins us tonight. Philip, how are you?
I'm great.
Tell everybody who you are.
A longtime college professor at UIC now, in an administrative capacity and teaching as well, and a fan and viewer of the show.
You've been on the show for well over, 15 years?
Yeah.
Something like that? Yeah. Marty Garrity, I think you win the title. You're over 20 years for you as a guest.
Oh, I think
maybe even 25, maybe 30.
Back in the early 80s, when you were still over
on... black hair and I had more hair. Tell us who you are.
There was less of me and less of you then, too.
Yes.
I'm a retired commercial real estate broker. I spent 45 years finding office space for tenants in mostly in the Loop, mostly in Chicago area. But in other cities too, I have 6 kids, all of them out of school, off the family payroll, 11 grandchildren, and I am enjoying retirement way more than I ever imagined I would.
Okay, well, welcome all to the show, the new and the old that join us each and every Sunday night. I want to get back to looking at the political aspect of this impeachment hearing and inquiry. Do you think, I'll start with you, Marty, it has been suggested over the last several months that President Trump really wants this because it gives him an edge. Do you think it does, or has the reality of the impeachment inquiry already shown its signs on him?
I think that I can't imagine anything that the Democrats could have done that would be more favorable for Trump than this impeachment inquiry. I think the people of the United States are going to look at this and say, these people have tried everything. Anything that, if he ever drops a piece of garbage on the sidewalk in a park, they're going to try to impeach him for that. And this is not something that the people of America are going to stand for. They want our congressmen and members of Congress to work with the president and get things done, like the USMCA, settle something that will keep our border secure, because right now our border, because the Democrats have refused to fund it, our border has failed.
So let's go to Phil Beverly.
I think the major difference between the idea that he wins by this impeachment, the guy can't get over 40% approval rating. And if you look at Bill Clinton, when he was impeached in 1998, so over 20 years ago, at the time of the Clinton impeachment, Clinton had an approval rating of 60%, and that skyrocketed to 70%. You're talking about an unpopular president being impeached. So I think those comparisons and thinking that he gets some kind of bump
is a bit misplaced. The second thing that I would want to say is that if I heard everybody right earlier, everybody agrees that in this phone call, he asked for a favor from another world leader, from a president of a foreign nation. Mm-hmm. I have to ask, is that favor then of any value to him? Or why would he be asking for it? Because if it is of value to him, then that's a violation of federal election law. And if that value is more than $25,000, it's a felony. High crimes and misdemeanors. So let's make sure that we're clear on the facts here. He asked for a favor. We all agree on that. The favor is of value. We agree on that. Or else he wouldn't have asked. He's the president.
Was the favor of personal value to him, or was the favor of revelation of information that he perhaps thought would never be revealed?
That it has to do with a political rival, it's always going to be personal. If he asked it about me, that's something different. I'm not running for president against him. He asked it about a political rival who, according to every poll that I've seen, beats him in a heads-up matchup.
Josh, what about that?
So I want to first of all respond to the politics. That was your original question.
That's right.
We're 14 months away from an election. And that's a big distinguishing factor between this and Clinton's impeachment. I mean, the Democrats are trying to take the choice away from the voters because they're scared that Trump will win with the voters again. His approval ratings are actually about 45%, but they're not great. I do take Phil's point about the comparison between Clinton and Trump's approval ratings. But no, it is not clear at all from this memorandum that he was asking for anything of value personal to him. Joe Biden doesn't have a right not to be investigated over his potential corruption with Ukraine. Just since he's running for president doesn't give him immunity from being investigated. And the president, in some ways, could be almost viewed as the real whistleblower here. I mean, this corruption with Ukraine stinks to high heaven. And he's right, as the chief executive of this country, to be concerned about it.
Responding to that. So
sure.
Absolutely reject that the Democrats are trying to take away some sort of choice from the people. The Democrats are protecting our country, protecting democracy, because our president has committed high crimes and misdemeanors and should thus be impeached.
Impeachment is not a conviction. Impeachment is impeachment.
And then
come on,
the
Josh,
Senate
you know
has
this.
To.
No,
it
but she just
trial.
Said that he
should be,
he
should be impeached.
And then I didn't
convicted
say,
of high crimes and misdemeanors.
No, she said she should be impeached.
Those are the qualifications for impeachment. And then it would go in trial in the Senate, which I do believe once we look at what else is on that coded server, there probably is other conversations. There's probably other things there. And currently, 55% of Americans, according to a CBS poll, they support the inquiry. And I think that more and more information that comes out, more and more laws that have been violated, we are going to be in a Nixon situation.
The problem with this is that you guys have been trying to impeach him since before he took the oath of office. There are Democrats on record saying, this guy needs to be impeached. We need to do everything to stop this guy. From November 7th on, you've never accepted that he is the legitimate president of the United States. He went through a 2.5-year Russian witch hunt,
allegations of obstruction of justice. That's a witch hunt.
None of them confirmed.
None of them moved you guys to impeach. None of them moved to impeach, and they're not obstruction of justice because
what the Mueller report says.
But the Mueller report says they're obstruction of justice.
Yes.
No, they didn't.
Yes, they did. That is
obstruction of justice.
Let me find the Mueller report then. If we're going to do that,
go ahead, Christine.
Why didn't Mueller recommend that he be indicted for obstruction?
Because he was following the DOJ guidelines that the sitting president can't be indicted.
So, isn't that a fact of life?
He's an employee of the Department of Justice. He can't. If he had said he should be indicted, then you'd accuse the guy of going rogue. You don't get to have it both ways.
No. But Mueller never said that there is definitive obstruction. He said, I'm going to leave this to Congress. And Congress sat on it and did nothing with regard to that.
No, he did say there's 10 counts of obstruction of justice. He left it with Congress as to what to do from there.
He didn't say there are 10 counts.
He said that he did not see obstruction of justice, but there were 10 points that obviously there was debate within the Mueller team as to whether or not they could indict or not. And they didn't come to a conclusion. So they were the information was thrown out there, but they did not say, because the other part of it is he also said, we're not exonerating him.
Right.
We're
That's
not
true.
Saying yes. We're not saying no. Here. You debate it in the court of public opinion, which is where we are right now.
Right.
Do you have an answer? Because we have to pause for a break. The music is a playing.
We'll come back.
So we'll come back. Stand by, because Philip Beverly is either going to have an answer that's going to stop the Republicans, or he is digging himself a deep ditch. Back shortly from Chicago.
If you look hard enough, go off the beaten track far enough, you'll find an America teeming with the unusual, the odd, the downright strange.
I'm Will Klinger, and I'm your guide on a package tour we like to call
Wild Travels.
Join us on our weekly road trip to see America's most offbeat and unusual attractions. Wild Travels, available on your local PBS station, or it darn well should be.
CSX moves forward, so do the rest of us.
Okay, we are back in Chicago, and Phil, you were you waving the flag that you gave up on your charge?
I couldn't get through a 448-page report of the Mueller investigation quick enough to find this. So I'll characterize it this way. So I believe that Mueller and his team found 10 instances of potential obstruction, which he did not charge Donald Trump with, because he was following DOJ guidelines about indicting a sitting president.
Right.
And he left it to the Congress to determine that it was a high crime or misdemeanor.
So I'm going to agree with the first part of Phil's sort of backtracking and say that he did find 10 instances of potential instruction. But he did not say that that I think that he obstructed or that he didn't obstruct. He did not exonerate him, nor did he charge him.
And so I'd ask this question.
Really said, what he really said was that there are these 10 instances where if we were going to go after them, we might find something, find actual.
No, it's a much stronger statement than that.
No,
he
no,
didn't,
it's not.
He, it was,
no.
he didn't, was not going to charge a sitting president with a crime.
No, he wasn't going to go that. After it, because if he did come up with something, he couldn't charge him.
Folks, we're going to put the Mueller report on the back burner for the time being. I want to talk about the whistleblower, but I want to begin the discussion. I'm going to begin it with you, Christine. Generally speaking, forget who the whistleblower is. Do you generally support the concept of a whistleblower?
Absolutely.
Josh, quick answers. Do you support whistleblowers?
100%.
All right. Phil Beverly.
Absolutely. I was
Marty
one.
Gary.
I agree that a whistleblower should be protected. But
Okay. All right. And I will let it flip. I totally agree that whistleblowers generally are to be believed, and I have generally supported them throughout my whole political career. Next question. If a whistleblower is politically motivated, does that make his charge any less important? Phil Beverly.
No, it's based on the facts.
Christine.
I agree with that statement.
Republicans.
It could be a factor.
It could be.
Yes.
And I would say in this particular case, it probably is, because this is an
example. Generally speaking, if something is politically motivated, does it make it automatically wrong, or Does it give it some validity in your mind?
There's always some validity to any kind of charge like that.
Okay.
But if the person is politically motivated, then it takes away some of the obvious.
Okay. So until we know the identity of the whistleblower, and we're supposedly going to know that, and he's going to testify, according to Adam Schiff, who was on all the shows today, until we know who or she is, we have to believe what they have said based on no direct knowledge. It's only the knowledge that's been provided to them, the hearsay that's been provided to them by six other White House staff people.
Bruce, I disagree that we have to believe the whistleblower. We have to investigate what the whistleblower is saying. We don't have to automatically believe the secondhand hearsay. And by the way, the rules regarding hearsay and whistleblower were changed 2 days before this was released, which I find awfully fishy. You used to have firsthand knowledge to report a whistleblower complaint from the CIA.
Changed
that was
by
changed
whom?
by the deep state, the intelligence community. It was changed.
This sounds very conspiratorial and
no
facts.
No, this has been reported. It is actually
the
deep state.
4chan? Who reported
give
this?
Give
Breitbart?
No, this is not Breitbart. This is not Breitbart at all. The rules regarding whistleblower were changed. It used to be that if you were a whistleblower, you had to have firsthand knowledge of the conversation.
Whose rules are these we're talking about? Are these CIA?
The intelligence community
the
rules.
The
so it's an admin,
rules.
Which the Republicans control.
The executive branch.
No.
There's
this
no way
is
that
administrative. Administrative changes.
And so they would need.
These are career bureaucrats.
But they would need.
Republicans.
Yeah, these are executive branch decisions, though.
But these
there's
are
no
people
way
that
the
are
deep
in,
state
these
did that.
People
whatever
that are in. That are in the government for many, many years. So they're not necessarily Republicans or Democrats.
Do you believe, Marty Garrity, do you believe that the six White House folks who talked to this CIA agent, and by the way, the whistleblower has been identified as a CIA agent. We don't know his name yet or her name yet. Are those six people, what are they, in your opinion, guilty of, if anything?
They are an example of the deep state deciding that they're going to resist the people of the United States, the election choice that they made, and they're going to stop the duly elected president from doing what he wants.
And they are on the White House staff.
Right. But,
I'm sorry. I thought this was a show where we talk about facts and not conspiracy theories in which there
is
no evidence.
This is not a
rumor.
But the people that work in
the
White
House? I want to go to Josh. And then I want the Democrats to respond, because you're basically saying, by the way, and I think the president believes that those six people, he wants to find out who they are. And by the way, he's been president for 3.5 years. He hasn't been able to find any leaks. And it's probably the leakiest administration in the history of the country.
Right.
What's your answer to the question? Those six people, they're chattering to a CIA operative who then becomes the whistleblower. What do you think of those six people? Are they loyal or disloyal?
I find it troubling that there are so many leaks in this administration generally. And we also have learned that this whistleblower complaint was drafted by a law firm. So it was very professionally done. This was a coordinated hit on Trump.
We got to pause. Back shortly from Chicago.
Welcome to the world, 2116. You can fly across town in minutes, or across the globe in under an hour. Whole communities are living on Mars, and solar satellites provide Earth with unlimited clean power. In less than a century, Boeing took the world from seaplanes to space planes,
across the universe and beyond. And if you thought that was amazing, you just wait.
Today, fresh fruits and vegetables will go from a field in California to a grocer in Miami. A bottle of beer from Eagle Pass will journey to a restaurant in Manhattan. A 2x4 in Oregon will find its way to a townhome in Denver. A hybrid will say goodbye to Detroit and hello to a showroom in Austin. While a steel beam will leave a mill in Illinois for a high-rise in Phoenix. And a flat screen in China will head to an electronics store in Memphis. Because today, as every day, wherever you find business, you'll find us.